he shouted battlefield orders in a bellow that rattled the halls of Montezuma. He thrived on combat until he became a legend to his troops, the toughest fighting man in the whole United States Marine Corps. And when he retired in 1955 as a lieutenant general, he was the most decorated man in Marine Corps history. Here is the story of the most courageous warrior and legendary Marine of all time, General Lewis Chesty Puller. Next on Marking History. This is the historical marker for Lieutenant General Lewis Burwell Chesty Puller. This marker is located in West Point, Virginia, where he was born and raised. In his 37 years of service in the United States Marine Corps, Lewis Puller, nicknamed Chesty, would rise through the ranks from private to general and become the most decorated Marine in American history. So how does a guy get a nickname like Chesty? We'll answer that question and more when we learn about the man behind the marker. Lewis Burwell Puller was born on June 26, 1898, in the village of West Point, Virginia, to parents Matthew and Martha Puller. Puller came from a military family. He was grandson of Civil War veteran Major John W. Puller, and cousin to another more famous soldier, U.S. Army General George S. Patton. Puller enrolled at his school of choice, the Virginia Military Institute, in 1917, when he was 19 years old. However, Lewis wanted to get into combat so strongly that he left VMI a year later and enlisted. Inspired by the Marines at Bellow Wood, during World War I, he enlisted as a private in the United States Marine Corps. June 27, 1918, Lewis Puller entered the Marine boot camp at Parris Island, South Carolina. He showed himself as a natural-born leader and was ordered to drill instructor training school. Months later, Puller and his men were given orders to prepare to ship out for France. Days later, those orders were canceled before he could kill any Germans. It was Armistice Day, November 11, 1918, and World War I was over. Later the next year, on June 4, 1919, Lewis Puller graduated from Marine Officer Training School at Quantico, Virginia, as a second lieutenant. On June 16th, Puller was discharged with hundreds of others of his rank due to post-war troop reductions. He had been a Marine officer for only 2 weeks. Now, the reason he had enlisted in the Marines was to pursue combat action. He found it in Haiti. When he heard about conflicts in Haiti, 21-year-old Puller re-enlisted as a Marine Corporal and deployed to the island in 1919 to battle the fierce, jungle-wise Caco rebels. His first taste of combat came soon after arrival and without warning. About 4 a.m., the pack train was ambling around a wooded bend when they met an oncoming Caco band of about 100 rebels. Proving his instinct for combat, Puller spurred his horse and yelled, "Charge! Attack! Hurry!" The column charged, horses, mules, and all. The Caco rebels broke for the hills. Puller's only casualties were superficial bullet wounds to 5 of his horses and mules. For the next 4 years in Haiti, Puller made a name for himself by leading several very successful jungle engagements against the Caco rebels. Puller fought some 40 battles and gathered valuable experience in soldiering and hand-to-hand combat during those guerrilla encounters. Puller developed his instinctive talent for utilizing terrain in battle and learned the lessons of jungle warfare. After his stint in Haiti, Puller returned to the U.S. in March 1924 and was recommissioned as a second lieutenant. Subsequently, he was assigned to the 10th Marine Artillery Regiment. During his training, Puller learned that junior officers were no help in learning about the big guns. It was the enlisted men and the senior non-commissioned officers who were the experts. Puller's next assignment was to handle the Marine Silent Drill Attachment. For years, Army, Navy, and Coast Guard teams have outshone the Corps in the National Silent Drill Competition. They had never won, despite their reputation as crack marching units. Lieutenant Puller took over with vigor. His message was, "We would bring home the cup or die trying." Puller took out the silent drill manual and started the training from scratch. When he was through, the men moved as one. The drill team gave him their all. At the Boston Drill Competition in 1925, the Marines wore rosin on their soles for safe, silent footing and went through their incredibly complex drill without a sound. When the competition was over, they had won their first trophy. In December 1928, Puller followed war to Nicaragua, a country even more rugged than Haiti. The Marine Corps was sent to train and lead the new Guardia Nacional forces against the guerrilla force led by the rebel chief Augusto Sandino. Chesty Puller's legend preceded him and served him well leading young men. They knew that he had their backs because he had humped through jungles, endured the harshest of conditions, and been wounded in battle just like them. Puller's Company M would earn notoriety among the rebels due to the ferocity they would employ in flushing them out. Puller's determination would earn him the nickname El Tigre in Nicaragua. Puller would lead his men and the Nicaraguan National Guard forces in over 60 battles against insurgents. Some say Puller got his famous nickname because of his big thrust-out chest. Others state that Chesty was an old Marine expression meaning cocky. A few claim that he developed the chest from shouting commands above the noise of battle. "We don't need no frontline communications," men under Puller bragged. "Chesty yells commands up and down the line. You can hear him for miles." It wasn't long before Chesty Puller was awarded his first Navy Cross, the second highest commendation for valor in combat. According to the citation, between February 16th and August 19th, 1930, Puller systematically led his forces into five successful engagements against superior numbers of armed bandit forces. His valor and achievements in battle earned him rapid promotion, and by the time he was shipped out from Nicaragua in 1930, he was a first lieutenant. In September 1931, Puller reported to Fort Benning, Georgia, and the Army's infantry school. It wasn't long before Puller started open disputes with his Army rifle training instructors. One lecturer told students that volume of fire in the field was more important than accuracy. That brought Lieutenant Puller to his feet.
"You must have forgotten what happened in the American Revolution. We won that war with accurate fire when the enemy had all the volume. It won at Kings Mountain and Saratoga and every other battle that we won. It's still like that. Anywhere I've seen men shooting it out, you don't hurt them if you don't hit them."
Puller returned to Nicaragua in September 1932. Upon hearing this news, the rebel bandit Sandino put a price of 5,000 pesos on the head of El Tigre. Lieutenant Puller earned his second Navy Cross for his combat leadership in actions between September 20th to October 1st, 1932. During that time, Puller's Company M completed a daring 10-day march of over 150 miles, fought four engagements, and killed at least 30 bandits. Although Chesty appeared to be a confirmed bachelor, he kept steady correspondence to a pretty brown-eyed girl which he met at a local dance in 1926, Miss Virginia Evans. Like a battle, Louis Puller kept up his siege to marry this girl, writing to her each day for the next 11 years. After his service in Nicaragua, Puller was assigned to many commands during the next 8 years. 1933, Peking, commanding the famous Horse Marines. 1934, on the USS Augusta Navy cruiser, serving under Captain Chester Nimitz. 1936, at the Philadelphia Officer Training School, where he was promoted to captain. 1937, November 13th to be exact, where he married his sweetheart, Virginia Evans. 1939, returned to the USS Augusta as commander of an onboard Marine detachment. 1940, Shanghai, commanding officer of the 2nd Battalion, 4th Marines. As tensions increased in the Pacific between Japan and China, the American military presence in China was drawn down. In August 1941, Puller returned to the U.S. and reported to the new Marine base in the North Carolina swamplands at New River, later renamed Camp Lejeune. There, he trained his men for a war he knew was coming. Guadalcanal was a jumbled landmass about 90 miles long and the nearest Japanese outpost to Australia, and a threat to American supply lines in the South Pacific. Soon after arriving on Guadalcanal in September 1942, Lieutenant Colonel Puller led his battalion in fierce action along the Matanikau River. It was Puller's quick thinking that saved three of his companies from annihilation. In the action, these companies were surrounded and cut off by a larger Japanese force. Puller ran to the shore and signaled a United States Navy destroyer, the USS Ballard. After boarding the ship, Puller directed the destroyer to provide fire support while landing craft rescued his Marines from their precarious position. For his actions, Lieutenant Colonel Puller was awarded the Bronze Star Medal with Combat V. Chesty felt every problem had a solution. Late one night, Chesty deliberately lit his pipe in the open and then quickly fell and rolled over in the dirt to draw machine gun fire from an enemy nest. His own gunners cleaned out the Japanese machine gun nest by firing at the muzzle flashes. Although Puller was a warrior to his men, he was a softy with his family. Not only did Chesty write to Virginia every day, he also sent his beautiful wife a dozen roses every 13th day of each month to commemorate their wedding anniversary. If we know Chesty, it was standing orders for the local florist. Later on Guadalcanal, Puller was awarded his third Navy Cross in what became known as the Battle for Henderson Field. Colonel Chesty Puller and his famed 1st Battalion 7th Marines saved Henderson Field on Guadalcanal one long rainy night by fighting off the equivalent of a Japanese division. Puller's men shoved away Japanese bodies to keep open their fields of fire. When the water supply gave out, they urinated into their liquid-cooled machine guns to keep them operating. Puller was wounded twice by bullets and half a dozen times by shell fragments. During the three-hour firefight, Puller's Marines suffered only 70 casualties. The Japanese force suffered over 1,400 killed in action, and the Americans held the airfield. It was in this battle that fellow Marine Gunnery Sergeant John Bassalone would earn his Medal of Honor for heroism. Puller was awarded his fourth Navy Cross for overall performance of duty at the battle at Cape Gloucester on the island of New Britain, New Guinea. After the commanding officer and executive officer were wounded, Lieutenant Colonel Puller did not hesitate to expose himself to rifle, machine gun, and mortar fire from strongly entrenched Japanese positions, moving from company to company in his front lines, reorganizing, and maintaining a critical position along a fire-swept ridge. He led the successful attack against heavily fortified Japanese defense positions. Casualties during operations to secure Cape Gloucester amounted to 310 Americans killed. The Japanese losses exceeded 2,000 killed. In September and October 1944, Puller led the 1st Marine Regiment into the meat grinder called Peleliu, one of the Palau Islands. They were sent in to capture an airfield on this small coral island. It was one of the bloodiest battles in Marine Corps history, and where Puller received his first of two Legion of Merit awards. The 1st Marines suffered 1,749 casualties from September 12th until they were relieved on September 30th. No Marine regiment has ever suffered as many casualties in a single campaign. Because of the incredible number of casualties, Puller's famed reputation was severely tarnished. Harsh criticism, much of it unjust or misplaced, would dog his reputation thereafter. At the outbreak of the Korean War, Puller was once again assigned as commander of the 1st Marine Regiment. He led his old regiment in a daring, amphibious assault on Incheon, during vicious street fighting in Seoul, and through the maelstrom of sub-freezing weather and relentless Chinese human wave attacks in the Chosun Reservoir campaign. It was during the Battle of Chosun Reservoir that Colonel Puller won his 5th Navy Cross for heroism. Massively outnumbered, Puller was quoted as saying, "We've been looking for the enemy for some time now. We finally found him. We're surrounded. That simplifies things." Puller and his Marines conducted a fighting withdrawal from Chosun Reservoir that crippled 7 Chinese divisions in the process. "We're not retreating," he told his Marines. "We're about faced to get more of those bastards. Be proud, you're 1st Marines." The final toll was 718 dead Marines and 3,500 wounded. Communist losses, supported by captured documents, 25,000 dead, 12,500 wounded. Over the next few years, Chesty Puller received promotions, Brigadier General, Major General, and finally, Lieutenant General. He served in various command capacities until he suffered a stroke on August 26, 1954. In 1955, over his roaring protests, Lieutenant General Chesty Puller was retired from the Corps on the grounds he was suffering from high blood pressure. After a decidedly noisy life, he died quietly on October 11, 1971. Surprisingly, not in Arlington Cemetery, but in his small Virginia town of Saluda, is buried the most decorated U.S. Marine of all time. In 1925, Lewis Chesty Puller was photographed with the Marine Corps' first mascot, the muscular, stubborn, and courageous Bulldog. Today, each new Marine Bulldog mascot is named Chesty Pullerton to honor the toughest leatherneck of all time. To this day, Marines at Parris Island end their day by saying the unofficial lights out slogan of the Corps,
"Good night, Chesty, wherever you are!"
If history can be taught with stories, it can never be forgotten. Please like our video, subscribe to our channel, and ring the bell to stay informed on the latest videos. And don't forget to leave your comments below and tell us what you like about this video.